Welcome to Jazz Biz 101, where we explore and share our journey as minority entrepreneurs with an emphasis on music business.
Okay, everyone, thanks for joining us again on this new episode of Jazz Biz 101. We have a very special guest today. He is an amazing saxophonist, composer, arranger, and you know, nowadays he's been creating some amazing content of his music, and obviously we're here to learn more about all the things that he's doing and how he's doing it. Dave Pollack, how are you doing today? You doing all right?
I'm doing great, Abel. Thanks so much for having me. I really appreciate it, and I'm really excited to talk with you guys today.
Awesome. And also we have Peter Lin, of course, my partner in crime. Yes, how are you doing, yes. Peter?
Hello, everyone. It's good to be back. Good to see Dave. It's been a while, man, for sure.
Absolutely. Yeah. We see each other post on, online and Facebook and Instagram, but it's nice to, have a little bit of a connection.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Definitely reconnect. Yeah. And I want to add to that list of amazing saxophonists and composer and whatnot. It's also educator on top of that.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Definitely, yep. Just years of experience, not only through the online learning experience, but also in person teaching every day.
Yeah,
man, I love all the different things that I had a chance to actually. Collaborate with you in person while when we used to have gigs and play, and I really admire your saxophone playing for sure, and I bet you're a wonderful teacher too as well, and we'll love to hear more about those beginnings of you playing the horn, and obviously we can evolve into different things that you're doing. Can you tell us a little bit about your initial days in music?
Sure. So I guess like a lot of people, or I hope like a lot of people, I started on piano when I was really little,
Oh, nice.
So I started, playing classical piano, doing the regular thing when I was like real, real small, like 5 years old or so. And then I started school band on saxophone when I was, in fourth grade. And then, getting into jazz in high school, I had a really good director. His name is Bob Gravener. Name is Bob Gravener. He's still around. Mm-hmm. He's a great trumpet player. He plays in the Philly Pops and had played in the Philly Pops for years and did random gigs around and stuff. So he was the one who really got me into playing jazz and just what actual jazz was and what music was beyond the band room, which I believe is important. And as I talk about, education, we can get into that too. But, a lot of kids think that music and instruments are in the band room. And then there's the real life music that you hear everywhere else. But it's we know that it's the same thing and it continues beyond that. And there's a whole other thing you can do out there besides just playing, marching band music or whatever. So he showed me that. And then, I went to William Patterson University where you guys know really well, WPU. And that was a fantastic experience being around so many people who were like-minded and, nice. Not just saxophone, but just, music and jazz, and pushing myself and pushing each other to do, great things, writing music and performing and trying lots of different things and, never just settling for being the big fish in a small pond of a high school somewhere, because everybody at a great music program usually was a big fish in their small pond of their high school. So you come to a place like William Patterson, like anywhere else, and you're around everybody else who's like, oh, there's other people just like me here. So that was really cool.
What was your concentration there?
So I was, this is funny. Actually, my first semester there, I was a music studies major. I think that's the term that it was called. I didn't make the jazz program my first year. First semester, I should say. But I reached out to Gary Smullyan, who was teaching there at the time. And I was like, hey, it was Don Braden and Gary Smulling were the two saxophone teachers. Wow. That was before Rich Perry, before Vincent were there.
Okay.
And I said, hey, this is in 2005. And I was like, hey, can I just get some lessons? So as we're doing lessons, one day he's like, hey, man, so you're not in the jazz program? I'm like, no, I didn't get in. He goes, hold on. And he goes and gets Dr. Demsey and he brings him into the room. He goes, all right, let's play something. And I was like, freaking out. I'm like 18 years old, and then Gary's like, man, put him in the jazz program. We were working on tunes and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, oh God. And so by the second semester, I was in the jazz program as jazz performance.
Wow.
Yeah, it was interesting. It was like one of these like weird things that I had thought I was going to re-audition, and I had like, you know, a little plan or whatever. Mm-hmm. And Gary, Gary, if anybody knows Gary, he's, you know, kind of eccentric, but always like a really like warm-hearted guy. He was like, no. He's like, I'm going to get Dr. Demsey right now. And I was like, right now? Like now? Like during the lesson, he left. And I'm just sitting there by myself like, you know. So that was pretty interesting. And then, you know, I don't know how much you want to keep going here, but I started thinking while I was there about, you know, what was going to be life afterwards? You know, what am I going to do after college? What am I going to do after I get a degree in performance? Mm-hmm. And I'd always liked, I can't say I like teaching because I never did it, but like, you know, the aspect of like, you know, jazz festivals and school festivals and that thing, I always dug that. So I ended up switching to their, at the time, new major called the jazz. It was called, I think, music education / jazz studies. I don't know what it's called now. It wasn't a dual degree, but it was like music ed degree, but with a
jazz focus. Concentration.
Yeah. So like my performing ensembles were still jazz. My lessons were jazz theory, jazz, but like I had all the music ed requirements. Mm. And so that's kind of how I ended up with, you know, teaching so much.
Oh,
so
I
there
see.
You go.
So when you finished your degree there, you had a certification already. You didn't have to certify again?
Nope. That was so you had that. And the tough thing was I think midway through my junior year when I switched. So I was there for 2 years plus a semester and I had to kind of catch up. So I ended up doing 5 total years, but I got the degree. It's, you know, K-12 public school music certification. Nice. And I got all those classes and, I graduated.
I remember, was it your senior recital was during, when I was there, I remember maybe you had a senior recital or something like that, but that was years after you graduated, right? Or
No.
I'm getting my timeline mixed up.
My senior recital was in actually the December of my senior year. So I actually graduated in spring of 2010. My recital was in winter of 2009.
Oh, okay. That's why I remember. Okay.
So cool. Yeah. So might be the timing. I don't know.
And then when, you know, as people that, you know, ever go visit William Patterson, you might see actually Dave on one of the photos there. Can you tell us about that? That's it's right there by the music office, right? I believe still there. Can you tell us about that trip? That's from a trip that you did, right? With the school?
You're talking about the trip to China?
Oh, that's right. Mulgrew. Yeah.
Yeah. So Mulgrew was there my whole time. I was there 2005 through 2010. And, I think it was 2008 because it was 2008 because that's when the Olympics were there in Beijing. Mm. And we were there in like October or November, like right after that.
That's amazing.
And it was really cool because we had this partnership with the Nanjing Arts Institute, sort of a partnership. I don't know how much they did travel back and forth, but, you know, we had some relationship with them and we had an ensemble that was specifically meant that was going to go there. It was like a septet or an octet. I think it was three horns. Eric on trumpet, Joe Schmidt on tenor, me on alto, and then it was piano, bass, drums, guitar, Billy Test on piano, Ethan O'Reilly on bass, Nate Webb on drums, and Adam LeMayo on guitar. I still know those guys, so it's all the cats, right? And there was a classical percussion ensemble that went too, which was pretty cool with Dr. McDonald.
That's a really awesome opportunity. Hopefully those things pop back up. William Patterson,
So Mulgrew went with you guys? Is that?
Yeah. So it was really cool. So Dr. Demsey went with us. I think Dr. Falk went with us and Mulgrew went, and it was cool because Mulgrew came in. He was directing the ensemble that year. He was the director or that semester. And so, you know, we kind of did some stuff, but when we got there, you know, he was with us for the trip and he would perform with us and stuff. Nice. And we got a chance to play with him on the stages and in the things. It was really cool. And that was a great trip. You know, we got to actually, it was more than just some performances. We got to like at the Arts Institute at their college, we got to like do a jam session with them, which was a whole separate thing because none of them spoke any English and we didn't speak any, you know, Mandarin, Chinese. So, but musically, as we all know, if we're going to play All the Things You Are,
just played a fight,
blues, yeah. So and they knew jazz, so it was cool. It was interesting.
It worked out.
It was a trip. Yeah.
Man, that's awesome.
Yeah, it was really cool.
So what was you know, you were saying you were thinking about life after college and whatnot, which is something I'm sure a lot of students think about or try to think about while they're at school. So what was your plan, you know, right after school? What do you end up doing that was like, you know, just part of your own execution there?
So I right when I graduated, I was toying, or right before, I guess, I graduated, I was toying with the idea of grad school. Now, I never went to grad school, so I don't have a master's degree or anything, just a bachelor's. So I thought about it, and Vincent Herring was telling me I should do it for this, blah, blah, blah. For good reasons. It wasn't, you know, forced me to do it. But I was thinking, I was like, I don't know, I don't know. And I ended up, when I graduated, I did my student teaching. During the student teaching, a job came up. It was just completely by chance at the Lawrenceville School, which is a private high school down here, right near where I grew up, like 10 minutes away down in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, near Princeton. And it's a private high school, and they were having a jazz director opening. And basically, I had no experience with private schools at all. That wasn't my thing. You know, I went to public school and everything. And it's basically set up like a college. Like, there was a jazz director whose job was, you know, he ran the jazz bands. And the guy before me also was a saxophone player. So he was also the saxophone and clarinet private teacher, because they would also hire instructors for every instrument, which is awesome.
Right.
So I was like, oh man, this is pretty cool. So I applied for it and actually got that job. So it was like, it was technically an adjunct position. It wasn't a full-time. So I didn't have health benefits. I didn't have, you know, it was just a regular, like a, you know, adjunct kind of deal.
What are those? Right. Where are health benefits?
it was interesting. And I was only actually there for 1 year because of the full-time nature. Something else came up that I'm actually still in that current role. So yeah, that was only 1 year, but it was really interesting transitioning from, you know, going to college, getting the degree, you know, going to public school, you know, practicum and student teaching and all. And then being at this private high school where they basically on the first day were like, here's your office, here's the music building, here's a key, basically do whatever you want. And I was like, whoa, you know, I was blown away because it was actually really cool.
Wow.
You know, and there's problems at everybody's location, but the problem to me anyway was this school is meant for kids who were getting ready to be doctors and lawyers and like ready to go to Harvard, ready to go to Yale. And like, you know, 80% of them going to Ivy League. So like studying Charlie Parker was kind of a little bit on the back burner, you know? So music ended up being more of like a stress relief kind of thing, than something to work towards.
Right.
Probably so also building up that, all that stuff. Credentials you need to get into college and whatnot. Yeah. Definitely helps with that, right?
Yeah, you can't blame the kids. You know, they're doing their thing and it was great. And the kids were great. I mean, you know, but that's kind of the vibe of those places. If you come in guns blazing saying, I'm gonna turn this program around and we're gonna do the Ellington Festival this year and we're gonna do that, they take you aside and kind of be like, well, you might want to pump the brakes just a little bit,
right? But it was cool. Much time.
Yeah, right. It was cool though. It was definitely interesting. And honestly, and talking about just jobs in general, that I would, if people out there, and I don't even know what the exact requirements were, but I don't think you need a teaching certification to teach at a private school.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, so I actually had a situation like that when Texas I taught for a year at a private school. And I didn't have a certification because I just got my, you know, my undergrad in performance, commercial music actually at that point. So, for people that are, you know, thinking about, you know, or coming up soon in this fall, they're about to graduate. You know, it's good that you know these things, you know, like you might need a certification if you did a performance major. Or if you did your education, I mean, you have to do your practicals, right? You have to actually go, your student teaching, right?
Yeah.
How was it? You did those in the public school, right? That's a little taste of a reality, right? Right there.
Yeah. I mean the for anybody that does the music ed thing, you know, you have to go through the 1 day a week for a while at one, you know, level, and then you do the everyday thing. And you know, it could be for people that are, and this is going down a different direction, but if you want to get into it, you know, for people who are like, I'm a jazz musician, like I want to be creative, I want to do this, I want to be up till 4 in the morning every day, like that would be a big shock to say, all right, you like I, in my student teaching, they had a zero period before school every day at 7 a.m. They had class. Woo. So I had to be there. Class started at 7. And I'm like, whoa, you know, I'm living on camp or living just off campus. And, you know, some of my friends had graduated. I was still living with them and they're up playing, you know, Call of Duty till 2 a.m. And I'm like, guys, I got to get up at like 5:30.
Yeah. Can't be staying up this late. Yeah.
Yeah. And sure. It was like, you know, and so it's not for everyone, you know, teaching mm-hmm. public school. But I think the thing is, and I think one of the reasons why you're doing this podcast and you're asking me specific questions like this is because there's not one answer. That's you know, right. Teaching right. Everybody, when you say teaching, at least 20 years ago, when I was in 2001. High school in 2001. So like, you know, 15, 20 years ago, you know, when you're in high school and you hear like my private teacher all through high school always told me to get an education degree. And I was like, no, I'm going to play in New York and I'm going to be touring around the world and I'm going to do this. And I'm not going to teach. What are you talking about? That's what like, you know, my corny right. band directors do. Yeah. My corny band directors that, you right. know, have a house and a car and health insurance and can play gigs. And that was the thing. And right. that's why I say it right. was cool to see my band director in high school, like who would go out and play gigs and, you know, be in Philly Pops and play, you know, jazz stuff. And there's when you say teaching, it doesn't mean you have to be a high school band director or like what I'm doing right now is middle school band director. You know, there's so many different elements to it that, you know, there's a lot of paths out there, you know, between online teaching, private teaching, master classes, community college adjunct, you don't need a master's for like you would for a regular university, you know, private high schools, this arts high schools, there's lots of different avenues for education. So when you hear music teacher, everybody always thinks of the band director with the lanyard and the short sleeve t-shirt with the tie, you know, short sleeve dress shirt with the tie, you know, everybody thinks of that, but right. there's a lot of versions of that. There's, yeah. it's definitely a spectrum.
And I think it's up to us too, right? To transform or, you know, really build that space where we want to be. And it's instead of just thinking, oh, here we go, you know, this is what I got to do now. I really, like I said, I really respected playing too. And I also respect the way of how you manage your teaching, and your performing. Cause you're a guy, like you said, like you're mentioning, you're a guy that teaches that wakes up at this, you know, at this time to go and teach the kids. And man, what a treat for them to have a teacher like you, because you know, the night before you're actually playing somewhere in the city, you know, or doing something. With music, I really respect that. Could you talk about like balancing that? Like, you know, especially as we describing kind of this path of like, okay, you know what? I could be a teacher and then I could also be a performer. How do you balance those things?
One of the things I think I have the most, I think I can help people the most with it when in talking is that because I didn't know about it. I didn't know about a balance beforehand. You know, we're taught, you know, if you're a music teacher, you're a music teacher. If you're a performer, you're a performer. If you're this, you're this, you're that, you're that. But especially as we all know now, especially in 2021, when this is being filmed in January, 2021, you know, there's no black and white anymore. Everything is a gray area. So as a musician, you know, whatever that means now, you know, balancing different things. So from my personal perspective, you know, I teach, like you said, I teach middle school, public school every day. I was teaching until 15 minutes before this interview started. Right. So every day, you know, Monday through Friday, it's a regular kind of deal. And one of the things I think is very important is to always use whatever resources and experiences you have individually to help in any way you can. Some of them can help a lot. Some of them might not, you know, and one thing that I've seen happen is when you have a really, really great musician who is a performer, who performs all the time, who goes to teach, who might not understand why a kid isn't getting something. And they're like, man, I don't have time for this. I played with, you know, the Mingus band last night. Why am I sitting here? And they think they're above it. And it's like, that's great that you did that. And that's great that you perform with all these great people and you do these great things. No one's taken away from that. But when I think the important thing is, like I said, there's no gray area, but when you're teaching in front of these kids, they don't need a fourth grader who's picking up a flute for the first time. It honestly, it's great that you played, you can play Giant Steps in 12 keys at 600 beats per minute. But if you can't connect with this 9-year old and give them the encouragement and the skills to pick up a flute and hold it correctly, they're going to quit music. It doesn't matter how great you are as a musician. You have to put on the, I'm the teacher hat. You have to put that ego aside of, yeah, but I have all these records. I have a billion subscribers on YouTube. You know, you have to put all that stuff aside for a second and say, what is my job right now? Right. But without not forgetting about it, use that, use pieces of that that would be useful. You know, some people go black and white with that where they say, well, why aren't you guys just getting it? I got it when your age. I was able to just play from, you know, when I was 5 years old. Well, not everybody is a musical prodigy or not everybody had that experience growing up. So, you know, you have to kind of, like I said, put that teacher hat on, but also like the balance of saying, you know what? Hey, when I teach a jazz band, for example, by the way, I'm wearing the hoodie right now, the merch of my middle school jazz band. when I teach middle school jazz band and we do a chart, I use my experience of, you know, playing jazz to say, you know what? I'm going to write out a soli for the band or for the saxophone section. I'm going to work with the soloist. There's a written solo here. That's the first thing I always make them throw the written solos away. It's always better to play a horrible improvised solo than a great written solo. That's what I always tell them. Unless it's a melody or something, you know, classic solo. But so I use, you know, that experience that other band directors might not have, because there's a lot of music, what's very interesting that you guys know, a music education degree has no jazz in it. At least as far as I knew. Maybe it changed.
That's right.
So there's a lot of directors that are teaching schools that run a jazz band that have never been in a jazz band. They're a classical flute player and or whatever, no offense to them, but they're a classical euphonium player and now they're teaching a jazz band and they're expected to run it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, whereas when I go to a festival, it's funny because you can actually hear, you can see the way they, if you conduct a jazz band like this, you know, probably you don't have jazz experience, which is fine. And just for anybody just listening, I was conducting like an orchestral like conductor,
band.
You know,
yeah, like a concert band.
But like, you know, so I know I'm kind of veering away from the question. I'll come back.
No, it's cool.
And you know, so it's about taking everything that you know and using it for the specific thing. Just like when I show up to a gig, I use my like my teacher show up on time thing to make sure I'm prepared. Right. You know, I'm wearing the right stuff. I'm there early. I have a pencil. I have all my equipment. Whereas some other people are like, oh man, I don't need that. Man, I don't need a pencil. I'll show up late. I got, I had a session last night. I don't have time to shower before. Like you guys aren't like that. You guys are the other way, which is the good way, I think, where you can take business side of things or other sides to the performing side as well. And then to actually finally answer your question about balancing it, it was a question I got in the interview for this job 10 years ago. They said, how are you going to handle playing a gig, playing Wayne Shorter tunes till 2 a.m. and then teaching fourth grade clarinet at, you know, 8 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I said, to me, music is not I do it for 6 hours or 8 hours and I forget about music for the next 18 hours or whatever. Music is 24 hours for me. So it just takes on different forms. So during the day, I'm teaching these kids. After school, I might teach a couple private high school students who are working on college stuff. You know, we're working on really advanced topics. Mm-hmm. Then I might play a gig at night, do a recording session. But then the next morning, it almost like, the funny thing is my day a lot of time follows a music career. In the morning, I'm teaching fourth graders. In the afternoon, I'm teaching advanced high schoolers. At night, I'll teach a gig, right? It like literally kind of follows that path. You know, not every night, obviously. But when that happens, it's really cool to see. And the balance is, from you have to just, for me, and whether it's YouTube stuff, whether it's teaching, whether it's performing, you just kind of keep going forward. What's the next thing? So yeah, I played a gig last night. It was great. I don't take 3 days off and talk about how great that gig was. It's let's wake up and let's do it.
Yeah. Well, you definitely seem like be in the moment kind of guy, and it definitely comes through in all the content that you put out, because everything's so focused, everything's so, and the comedy is just really great in all of your content. I'm wondering, do you use like a lot of the stuff that you do outside of teaching to also inform the students, like, if, you know, just to have fun and stuff like that, like, oh yeah, here's a video I did, you know, that, like, do you ever get in that mode?
The funny thing is, I try not to. I try to keep it separate. The kids know I have a YouTube channel, especially like the older ones they teach. They all know, and they like, I see them comment on it and stuff. I never respond. But I try to actually, I mean, I guess I'll, if it's like very appropriate, like if we're doing a big band tune that I like did like a virtual tune of, I'll like show them specifically. But other than that, I actually try to keep it separate. Once again, for that, I think for that ego thing, I try to, unless it's actually going to help them, you know, but otherwise I don't like to bring it up often just because I don't know. I feel like it might be one of those things where it's like, keep looking at what I'm doing. I'd rather look to other people. I do show them YouTube stuff. I try to find other people. I try not to use my own stuff for my own students, you know, because I don't know. It just feels odd. Unless I feel like, you know, my one video is the best way they can learn something, then sure. But like 99.99% of the time, I don't. Mm. So, yeah. So, man, I don't know. Yeah, it's just one of those things I just try to keep a little separate.
Man, I was just going to say that I really love the way that you explain, like the way that you balance things. And to me, it sounds to me, correct me if I'm kind of far away from it. It's almost like if you're developing like these different skills that and you taking a piece from one and a piece from other, you know, and it's instead of like, you know, like the case that you mentioned, you know, like the musician having to wrestle with the situation of, man, last night I was playing at Smalls or I was playing at, you know, Jazz Standards or whatever. And now I'm teaching a kid, you know, like really having to wrestle with those things. And then the thing that you mentioned about the business, which is one thing that we definitely would really like to dig in, of like on top of you teaching and top of you playing your music, the content that you're creating, man, like and the skills, the other skills that you're developing, like video editing and audio mixing and all those things that are really kind of, you know, really shedding light into what a musician is doing now in 20 or has to really take care of right nowadays. Can you talk about more like that skill that you're developing?
Yeah, absolutely. And I like how you use the word developing because this is a new thing for me. Mm. The video editing, talking in front of a camera, audio editing, which I admittedly am not that great at, the audio part. The video part I'm much better than the audio, but I'm learning, but I'm developing, you know, as you say. So the funny thing is about my YouTube channel is when I first started like actually making videos to put on there, I told myself never to do any legit videos. I only wanted to do comedy stuff, but like, or like goofy stuff or just like post a gig. But then like people wanted legit stuff. And I was like, oh, I guess I have to. That's a whole nother topic of like the market saturation of that, whatever. But like, yeah. So these skills of like, you know, learning how to edit and learning how to, you know, create content and learning because just YouTube itself, like every platform has its own like things that you should be aware of. Like there's people that know how to post on TikTok now. There's people that are big on Instagram. It's hard to like kind of transcend all of them. So I focus most of my effort on YouTube stuff because I feel like it's a good hub because it's public. It's always archived. You can basically put whatever you want there on any length and people can always find it. It's searchable on Google. Mm. And you can link it to anywhere else as well. So, which is cool. So, you know, when I started trying to just do stuff on there, I would be critical of myself and say, you know, why is this do better than this one? Why are people liking this one? Why are people doing this? And then I didn't even like about the video editing stuff. I never even knew about that until like 4 or 5 years ago. I was like, man, how does Jacob Collier do that? How does he put himself on the screen like 100 times, you know? And mm-hmm. and I saw that and I talked to a few people and I learned, oh, if you have this audio, this video editing program, you can do these things. So I got that program. And then basically, and it's so funny, I tell people this, I learned everything I know how to learn. Everything I do on video editing, I learned from watching tutorials on YouTube. Literally, yeah. Like that's all I do is just watch YouTube tutorials about everything. Yeah. Like, you know, and you guys do the whole thing about the streaming and you have the whole OBS setup and that's more advanced than the stuff that I do. But like, I'm sure you could probably learn a lot of that.
Oh yeah, man. That's the real advice right there. It seems like people don't get it. It's, you know, even we, you know, we talk to some people that come to us and they're like, oh man, you know, how do you do this stuff? And it's funny because it's like, man, we learned this in YouTube, man. Like there's, you know,
it's out there.
Yeah. That how to for everything.
Exactly.
The great thing about YouTube is that there's so many specific channels or just specific videos that you can find instantly. Like you could search the most specific thing. Hey, in Final Cut Pro, how do I fix this one transition? And like that's 800 right. other people already searched for that. So this that's video right. comes up that somebody made. And the yep. cool thing about it is because people can make money from it and make a career out of it, they're trying to make the best videos they can. So they try to make the best videos they can. We get to watch them for free, and the consumer benefits from it. Because, you know, hey, if they realize a lot of people watch this video about a specific editing technique, they're going to make it. We're going to watch it. We're going to learn and then pass on what we know.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And just, yeah. So combining that, and that's just like specific talking about YouTube stuff that I do.
Right.
But just even stuff like, you know, now I've been doing, well, since, you know, about 10 months ago, I've been doing a bunch of virtual masterclasses. So the first one I did, I used my webcam on here, you know, that you guys are seeing that no one else is seeing right now, but you guys are seeing, and it's, you know, it's a computer webcam. It looks, you know, not great. So I looked into, like, I have a camera, I have a mirrorless camera. I'm like, how can I turn that into a thing? So I researched, oh, you got to get the Elgato cam link and you get this and the setup. And so now when I do it, I have the full lighting setup. I have the cameras, I got the interface. And I think that, you know, some people are hesitant to jump into that world because they don't understand it. You know, as a musician, I had no idea what shutter speed was. I had no idea about 24 frames per second. Is 120 better? Like, higher numbers should be better, right? Like, you don't know those things. And it's like kind of scary to jump into, especially, like, you know, if you're coming from a creative jazz musician side of things where you're playing an acoustic instrument. At least guitar players kind of get used to electronics. Like, I didn't. I had no idea. Players, I didn't know what a condenser microphone was like 5 years ago. Even through college and stuff, I was like so, I had no idea. I like almost wanted to stay away from all that stuff. And I think a lot of people are like that. They're like, and once again, it's one of those things like, I'm a musician. I'm not the one recording. I'm not the sound engineer. That's their job. But nowadays, you're your own engineer. You're your own publicist. You're your own editor. And, you know, I implore everybody out there to just get into it. Because if you have a phone, if you have a smartphone, that's all you need. Nowadays, you can do editing. You can take great video. You can, the audio, you know, is okay. And you can get through it. There's no excuse to put something out there. It's there.
Yeah, it's definitely becoming easier and more consumer friendly. Also, budget wise, it's definitely like becoming cheaper just for a general user. And I think it's something that, you know, during this time we're all inside, and you know, this is just the way everyone's asking for remote recordings and whatnot. But you know, Dave, you've been doing it like way before the pandemic in a lot of ways. Just look, if you look at, you know, some of the videos on his YouTube channel, it's definitely you have those split screen videos like, will this instrument play, and then you like combine different instrument parts, and then like you're playing together with yourself, and like you know, so a lot of those skills that you wanted to learn was more because of the fact that you were seeing, like, you know, some other content creators you're influenced by, you know, what you were seeing. So like for your channel, do you have particular influences, other, you know, YouTube creators that you look up to and like definitely like emulate or try to, you know, be in that same community?
Yeah, absolutely. And the funny thing is, most of the influences I had on the channel and still currently have are not music channels. Mm-hmm. I watch a lot of non-music YouTube stuff, like a lot of, I used to be into cars really big. So I watch a lot of automotive YouTube, right? Okay. So, and I like, it's almost like, and for the jazz people out there, it's almost like transcribing elements of people of different styles. Like, just because you're a trombone player doesn't mean you can't copy elements of a piano player. Just because you're a singer doesn't mean you can't copy elements of a, you know, flute player, whatever. So it's almost like transcribing those. And I think it's one of those things where when I see, like, for example, a B-roll of slow motion B-roll and the way they film a car, I'm like, man, how can I put that into my videos and bring it to music? Because if I film all my videos and shoot my videos and structure them like all the other music videos, I'm just copying what they're doing. But if I take a little bit here from this car video, a little bit from, you know, a specific like video editing channel, like for example, Peter McKinnon, I love his channel, you know, it's from Toronto, him and Maddie Hapoya, and also Daniel Schiffer, is where I learned a lot of the handheld B-roll stuff. That's what he's big into. Mm. And I learned about how to, you know, do the focus and about lighting and all the actual, like, how to film stuff from that. So that's a lot of my inspiration for that. And then, like I mentioned before, like Jacob Collier was probably the person who got me into like the split screen stuff, just because I guess he was really one of the first people, at least in our style of music, to really pioneer cloning yourself like that, you know, putting it on the screen And I was like, that looks pretty cool, because he didn't, because the thing about it is it didn't look like I needed a special equipment. Like at that time I was looking at the boxes, so I didn't need a green screen, which I still don't have, but he looked like he was just literally filming himself separately. I was like, I want to be able to do that. So that's an influence for me. Mm-hmm. You know, like I said, Peter McKinnon and those guys for that, you know, and just like random like tech review channels, like Marquez Brownlee, when he does like tech review of like Apple products, he has 10 million subscribers. So he's doing something right. You know, he does like Apple, like computer reviews, and the way they film it and the text they put on the screen, I try to emulate some of that and the way they structure the videos. So, you know, and the comedy videos are my favorite stuff to do on my channel. So it's like comedy videos that are music related. So I just like to watch random sketch comedy videos and stuff too.
Hey man, gotcha. Right before actually starting really diving into this world of YouTube and creating content, was it like more organic that you were like, okay, I'm going to do a couple of videos and then see how it goes and learn from them? Or was it like, I'm going to do a bunch of research before and then I'm going to jump on it?
So it definitely was not the second. It was definitely the former. I think I literally posted my senior recital on back in 2009. And like, I just put it there because it was like, oh, you can just put it on YouTube. Because back then it was like, it wasn't a thing. And even when I did a couple videos back then, I didn't do it. I definitely did not research and do all the stuff that I do now that I was just talking about, you know, how to film and all that. Mm-hmm. I basically just put stuff on, like I'd put a gig video on there, like of a clip from a gig or something, a cell phone video. I just prop a cell phone up and then I would just upload it, you know? And I didn't think of it as making a video for YouTube. It was, oh, I have this video from a gig. Where can I put it? Let me just, oh, YouTube is a platform where anybody can put it on there. Let me do that. I honestly, it was only really when I did the Grammy band video, which is funny because like so many people know my channel. They're like, that's the first video I saw you. Because that was the first video where I made a video for YouTube. Mm. That was when I was like, you know what? I have an idea. And I actually like made a script and did the video and put it on YouTube. That was like the first, I think, time. Before that, it was just like, I just like had a GoPro and I set it up and I recorded whatever. Let me just put it on YouTube because that's where you can put it, you know?
Right.
So it's only been a few years, maybe like, I don't even know what year that was. Maybe like 3-4 years.
Oh, wow. Mm. Yeah, that's not too long ago.
No, yeah, it wasn't. Sure. I forget but it might've been 2017.
Mm. Yeah. That's amazing to hear the beginnings of how it all started for sure.
Yeah.
Abel, you had a question?
I was just going to say, so you basically, you're mentioning that you transformed the way that you were approaching of making a video and just putting it on YouTube versus really now, would you say that now you write a script of your videos? What's your process, if you don't mind sharing?
Oh, 100%. So the thing about my channel, and I think this is something that is important to me, is that my channel name and my whole channel thing is just my name, right? It's not Dave Pollack saxophone or jazz. So I like to always keep it authentic to myself, as cliche as that is. I don't want to like just do one thing because I think it would make me money. Now, if somebody said, hey, you make these videos, you'll make $1 million. You better believe I'm going to make these videos. But that's kind of not the reality of it. Right. But yeah, so now so with that being said, yes, I do. I have like a sheet that's like, it's called 2021 videos. And I have lots of video ideas. When I think of them, I put them on there. And I do write a script for any video where I'm talking, I write a script for. Now, because I've learned, one of the things I've learned really well and goes back to balancing time is efficiency when recording. When I first started thinking of videos to record where I would talk, like explaining something, I would just turn the camera on and start talking. And it would take me like an hour and a half to record a 3-minute video. Now, when I script it out and I know where the cuts are going to be and I write it in sentences and bullet points, I can record a 3-minute video in like 7 minutes. I can just like super quick go through it because I'm also better at talking in front of the camera. I don't stutter as much. I don't like I used to. I don't look away and I don't make noises and stuff. So yeah. So now I'm much better at it. And I do script it out, but I still like, if I play a random gig, I'm like, I still try. I like to film stuff just because I like having it to archive it. I also have a really rough memory. So That's a separate issue, but I have a bad like long-term memory. So it's nice to like remember like, oh, look, I completely forgot about that gig. It's nice to have that archived. So if I do a gig and I'm like, that song was really cool, I still feel the freedom to just post it up on YouTube, even though those types of videos on my channel anyway don't do that well. Like right. just a gig video, like, hey, here's this big band playing a blues. Like, even though I would think it's awesome, right. but a lot of people would rather see me, you know, dunk my saxophone in the ocean or something to light it on fire. So,
how do you manage all of that content? Because, you know, I think people that are interested in keeping up with like weekly content, it can become a hassle, like just trying to do it so last minute every single week. Like, oh, I got to put something up. So,
well, as you know, the answer is to not do it last minute.
Yeah.
But I do that though. Sometimes, and it could be a blessing and a curse. Like sometimes if I get an idea, I'll literally have the idea, write the script down, and then film it like all in like I'll be sitting on the computer at night and I'm like, oh, this would be a great idea, and I'll do it fast. But I try to not do that. So obviously the idea is, you know, try to not maybe backlog videos because you don't know how they're gonna come out or whatever, the order and all. Mm-hmm. Whatever, but I think it is good to always be looking ahead. So like when I post a video, when I like, for example, I had a video go live at 3:30 today when we started recording. I scheduled it to go live. But just when I post a video, that's not when I start the next video. I already have another video coming out tomorrow that's already ready. Mm-hmm. The video that's coming out next week is already done. And I already wrote the script for the video after that. So I'm always like a couple videos ahead. I'm always working on videos, and I think that's important for people if they want to be consistent. Now, the thing is about YouTube, if you're just doing it to just put out content for fun whenever you want, mm-hmm. you don't have to do weekly. There's no pressure really for that. But like you said, if you are trying to build something, people do like consistency. And with the oversaturation of YouTube and just the internet in general, if you post every week and then you miss 1 week, somebody's going to watch 80 videos in that week that you didn't post and maybe forget about you, and they're not going to pop up in their notifications anymore. Mm. So that's why it is kind of important to do that. So I would definitely recommend not even finishing all the videos and backlogging them, but always be working on multiple things at once. And that's, once again, you have to balance your time. You have to balance these things. Now, if your videos are more involved and they're bigger projects, you know, me sticking a trumpet mouthpiece in an alto is not a big project. I can kind of do that quick. You know what I mean? Like that's a simple thing. The next one I have coming up is also going to be a simple thing, as you'll see in a couple of weeks. But like, you know, I think it's always good to just keep churning stuff out, especially in this day and age. It's not like, oh, I came out with one album, I'm just going to ride this out for 10 years and go on tour and do album releases. Right. It doesn't work like that in any sense. As soon as you put something out, people consume it, they throw it away. Next, what's next?
Yep.
And it can be exhausting, but I do it because it's fun for me. The day it just becomes like, oh my God, I have to do a video. I have to, unless it is my full-time job, in which case, you know, some days it's like that. If it's just the side thing, I'm not going to stress myself out for it.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So how much of a, can you reveal to the audience what it's actually like to, you know, have a larger YouTube channel? Like, is it as lucrative as people think it is?
Well, I destroyed my Lamborghini the other day, so I'm just going to buy 4 more this week. just so people know, like YouTube is based on views. So it's not based on subscribers. Subscribers are good because that many people can get notified of your videos and that many people can see it and share it. But theoretically, you can have as many subscribers as Mr. Beast, 50 million. Yeah. But if only 5 people watch the video, you're not getting paid for the subscribers. You're getting paid for the 5 views, right? So I like to think of even, you know, I don't have like Better Sax channel has 200 and something thousand subscribers, Jay Metcalf. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a bunch of other YouTube channels. Adam Neely is one of the biggest exceptions. He has over 1 million, right?
For sure.
So his channel, that's a full-time job. That's his job. And especially in the last 10 months, but that's a definite job. Mm-hmm. And the amount of views he gets is a full-time job. Right. You know, where I'm at, it's still just for fun. And, you know, if you want me to talk numbers, I can talk some numbers if you want, just so people know.
Sure. Yeah. I think it'd be good for people to know.
Yeah. I'll give you wide ranges. And this varies widely. So there's the number one way people make money on YouTube. I'm not saying the best way, but it's the regular way is by ads on your channels. So you need 1,000 subscribers and I think 4,000 hours of watch time on your channel in the last year. So once you have that, you apply, you're in, you can, they put ads on your videos. Mm-hmm. You know, if it's under 8 minutes, I think you get one ad like in the beginning or maybe during, and then after 8 minutes now you can put as many ads on as you want. So like some people go overboard. They put an ad every like 2 minutes on their channel for yeah, a 10 minute video. You know, those. It gets a little, so on average, and this is a wide range, you make $2 to $7 per 1,000 views per ad ish. It's a super wide range. Like finance channels get high because a lot of people that watch them are high net worth people, or they want to be. And then the people advertising are for like, you know, investment firms and bank with us and stuff. So it's like high dollar stuff. Music sadly is on the lower end, but you know, so if you take, honestly, if you look at a video just, and here's the thing, it doesn't matter the size of the channel. The, like I said, it pays out per view. So if you have, as long as you're allowed to have ads and you're in the partner program, 1 million views on my channel is the same as 1 million views on Adam Neely's channel. Mm. The difference is he gets 1 million views often. So 1 million view video is going to make between $2,000 and $7,000, but if it has five ads on it, it might make $30,000. So it's like it depends, you know. And if people stop watching before the ad shows, you could put 100 ads on the video. If they watch 10 seconds of it and click out of it, doesn't happen.
You don't get paid for that. Yeah,
you don't get paid for that. It's and they know they have the whole thing, like YouTube's, you know. They don't charge the advertiser unless the ad is seen.
Yeah. Right. Well, that's really intense. And yeah, thank you for sharing all those numbers.
Yeah. Well, that's why that's light, you know. Yeah, when you know, that's why there's this whole other thing. If you're trying to make videos for YouTube to get people to do it, there's a whole other side and a whole, when you read the analytics and how to have a good thumbnail and a title and how to keep people at certain times. Like you'll see, I'm sure everybody has watched some type of video, not even music related, where they're like, all right, and now let's see what happens. Ad. Right? You're not going to click out. You're going to wait through that ad and see what happens. Say. Oh my God. We're going to fill the saxophone up with water and see what happens. Ad. Perfect timing. Everybody's going to stay through that ad, right? So it's not coincidental why people do that. And it's also, you know, that's where it starts turning into the business side of things, where you have to, you don't have to, but that's if you want, you know, certain things, you have to kind of do them that way. So yeah. But I think it's still, you know, for me, it's definitely fun more than, you know, the money side of it or whatever.
Right.
That's the key, right? Like if it's, if you're pushing yourself to do something that you're not enjoying, it's going to reflect on your product too at the end. Quick question, man. So you were creating content before this pandemic, way years before. How did you see, a positive impact? Because I know we saw a lot of negative impacts on a lot of things, you know, like not playing gigs and whatnot. But how did it impact your content creation during this pandemic year?
So that's a great question, because it actually has two sides, I think. There's a positive side in that, you know, we all had more time, just, you know, time at home, and we're kind of forced to be sitting in front of our computers. Like we said before, you know, our back and our knees aren't doing so great from just sitting around our hips all the time, but it forces us to kind of be here. So if you use that time wisely, you know, sitting in front of the computer doesn't just have to be consuming mindless YouTube videos. It could be creating mindless YouTube videos for other people to consume. So there's that side. And the other good thing, the other positive is, because a lot of people are home, more people are consuming content than ever. So instead of going out on a Friday night, they're watching YouTube videos. Instead doing this, you know, whatever, they're doing that. And also for me, on a personal note, I've gotten messages from so many people around the world in the last 10 months for either consistent or just one-off lessons, because they say, hey, because now, you know, online lessons are such a thing. And, you know, my own personal private lessons that I would always go to their houses, those are not happening in person. You know, they haven't. So that they're online as well. But I've had people reach out to me from Israel, from Brazil, from, you know, Australia, all over the place, say, hey, can I get a lesson? And it's like, we can do that now that I would have obviously never been able to do. So those are positives, at least that I've seen. The negatives obviously are, just the whole weight of everything is like, it's harder maybe for some people to kind of dig deep and get that motivation or get that creativity, you know. And the other thing is the oversaturation, right? Like I did virtual things like you clone yourself before the pandemic. And like, mm-hmm. I think people were like, whoa, that's so cool. How do you do that? Now everybody I think knows how to do it, or at least they've seen it so much that it's not like this cool new thing anymore. It's a thing that everybody does, which that's is, right. you know, like my Christmas Tune of the Day series this year was all virtual. Everybody, you know, tons of videos. Yeah. Last year when I did it, I did like 3 videos like that. And people were like, whoa, how'd you record this? Whoa. It was just, you know, so, but like anything else in life, it's, you know, it's new at first. It's new and shiny. People get used to it. And then we move on from it. It's how you use it. So,
right.
you know, but personally, like I've found more motivation to make stuff, you know, now because I'm forced to be home and because people are consuming. And I think they're looking for something interesting to watch or interesting to, you know, learn. So yeah, that's how I see it.
And you still have your wife. She hasn't left you or anything, right? You
no, she's still here. And you know, it's a funny thing, not about leaving me or anything, but it's funny because this one guy that I've that I was talking to, and he was like, "Man, he was like commenting on like a actual like music video. He's like, "Man, your wife she's so lucky. She gets to hear so much great music." And I was like, "Well, considering 90% of the stuff on my channel is me playing weird Frankenstein instruments and, you know, honking in the corner." And, you know, and right. another funny thing is that people don't realize, like, when you're recording like virtual big band or virtual multiple parts, the only part that sounds good is the melody part. You know how a second tenor part sounds, Abel. When I'm recording second tenor, she's hearing da 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 da. That's what it sounds. Peter, how imagine hearing third trombone for an hour.
Oh yeah.
Right?
Well, that's me every day, but
I know, so that's why it's funny. It's like, you know, you see the people see the final product, like, oh man, it must be great to hear that being recorded. Not always.
Not particularly.
Yeah. Second alto and second tenor aren't the best.
I'm glad. Yeah, I'm glad that I think we all in this meeting we all have understanding wives. You know, shout out to the wives.
Hey, 100%. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And yeah, she went to school for music education at first. Actually.
Oh, cool. Oh, okay.
And then she actually got a brain and switched to science.
No, figure it out.
I'm just joking.
No, that's wonderful, man. So many things that you really kind of shed some light on, is, you know, all the way from like going to school to like really knowing what to do after school to like now transforming into like today's world. Like, you're a guy that's, you know, people look out for, you know, for their videos, either if they're funny or if you want to, or if you're talking about Kenny G or, you know.
Oh, yeah. Keeping it sexy.
Yeah. Thanks for showing us that beautiful keeping it sexy.
Yeah. I've definitely seen, you know, one note of mention is I saw this musician. He's usually pretty like critical about, you know, people posting videos and whatnot. But he shared one of your videos, which actually didn't come from your channel. I think someone actually like reposted your video, which I was like, oh, I don't know who. I was like, oh, this is a little suspicious. But regardless, he shared, he's like, man, not only is it funny, but this guy can play. Who is this guy? And I was like, oh, that's Dave Pollack, you know.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. And I was like, you know, it's just amazing, man. Like, you keep it relatable too, you know, on top like the comedy, but also the music is just so killing, man.
Yeah, it's real.
You
know? Yeah,
yeah.
It's
real. Thank you. And hard I think balance. that's like, once again, I try to be a model of like gray area. That's what I like to be. Like, you know, I might not be as good of a player as Chris Potter, and I might not be the best teacher in the world, but I try to like do each of those things well enough that I can hang in all of them. Like, when I'm a teacher, it's cool that people don't know I'm a musician and do videos. When I do comedy videos, it's great that they don't know what I actually do. When I play a gig, I like that people don't realize I'm a teacher at first. Like, I try to, whatever I'm doing, I try to be the best at that, you know, not like, oh yeah, he plays pretty good for a middle school teacher. Oh right. Yeah, you teach band pretty well for a jazz guy. Like, I try to have it just be its own thing. And maybe that's also why I don't like to cross over sometimes, because I don't want to seem like there's an excuse for anything. Like, Yeah, I may have taught all day, but there's no excuse for me to miss that entrance at this gig tonight. Like, I don't want you to, well, right. Well, he's a middle school. He was up at 7, so.
That's right.
You know, yeah. Like, I don't want that. Don't give me your pity.
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
for sure. No. Yeah, so I try to do all that stuff, and it's fun for me. Like I said, it's all fun.
Man, what are some of your goals, man? What are the things that you see Dave Pollack doing, playing the saxophone, creating content, and you know, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, I don't know if I can, because it's interesting. I never really set like specific goals, and that might be, or maybe I should start. But you know, like I kind of just keep going and see what happens. That's kind of how I've done all this stuff. Like, I never thought I'd be making YouTube videos. I never thought I'd be teaching master classes to colleges around the country. I never thought I'd be doing half the stuff I'm doing. So I try to just kind of do that. But I guess if I had one goal, it's to get Kenny G on a video. That's my ultimate life goal.
Yes.
All right. So yes. So I'm just throwing that out there. If anybody knows how.
So Kenny, if you're listening.
I'm surprised he hasn't reached out to you yet.
That's what a lot of people say. I'm going to keep at it. No, I'm not joking about that. That'd be incredible. I think people would just lose their minds if that happened. But, you know, I've been wanting, and I'm like, I'm one of these guys, I procrastinate. I know it doesn't sound like I do, but I do. I've been wanting to just put out an album of my own music for so long now.
Yes.
There's no excuse. I have zero excuse.
Yes, man.
I don't want to do it like right now just because of everything going on, but like I have music. I've written a ton of stuff that I've used to play at gigs and stuff. And now it's just sitting here, you know, and especially with like, you know, Bandcamp, where you can sell it there, or streaming, and you can share it all around the world real easy.
Right, right, right.
You know, there's no excuse. I do want to do it in a studio, like live. I don't want to do it remotely.
I was gonna say that. Yeah,
if you were because like do it I can do all these other things remotely, and they're as you guys know, they're just not the same. And if I'm doing like, if I'm finally doing an album, because I've never actually done an album of like my own actual stuff,
like a soloist, right? Like,
so I want to do it real. So maybe at the end of this year. You know, but that's a goal. That's like a personal goal of mine. You know, I don't have any like specific like YouTube goals. Like, I want to hit this many subscribers. I want to do this many.
Right.
I just kind of go, and when the moment strikes me, I make a video. But yeah, that's, I guess those are the two big things. Obviously get Kenny on a video and then put out a legit album of all my original music.
Yeah, yeah, man. Well,
that'd be amazing.
That would be really cool, man.
Yeah. I'm sure all the fans, committed fans already would love to hear something like that, you know?
Yeah.
I'm sure people asking for it.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I'm hopeful.
So, what's the best way for people to really get to your content, or to do you give consultations, or to even reach out to you for lessons and whatnot? What's the best way to get in touch with you?
So I guess nowadays the easiest way is if you send me a message on Instagram at Dave Pollack Music, or an email, DavePollackMusic@gmail.com. Those are like the easiest way to directly reach me. And
awesome.
Yeah, and that's the easiest way probably to find me. Those are the main platforms I use, is Instagram and YouTube, but like there's no real message feature on YouTube.
That's
so right. if you're looking for like some people sometimes comment like, hey, do you give lessons? But if it gets buried in a bunch of comments, I don't see it.
That's right.
But an Instagram, DM or an email. And I've asked, honestly, like, not that I'm I'm definitely not like a videographer or an audio engineer or anything like that, but like for people who want to sort of just get started, like I think I can help them out with a little bit, because I was that person like not long ago. You know, right. I'm definitely not like the child prodigy, well, of music or of video editing. It's not like so I can maybe help people out and help them not waste time like I did in the beginning too.
Well,
so.
Man, your videos look killing.
Yeah, they're great.
They sound great too. And you know, so I checked out a couple of your videos. Wait, let me see what he's doing over here in terms of video editing.
Yeah.
You know,
I want to actually, it's funny you guys bring that up, and this is probably not for the podcast, but I wanted to talk to you guys about the streaming stuff. You know, and ask you guys about your whole streaming thing. Cause that every time I see a picture of that and you got the Black Magic camera or multiple out and I see the whole, you got the whole deal set up, and I'm like, man, that's cool.
Yeah, we've been doing some of those live streams too as well.
Yeah, always upgrading production, man, for sure.
That's right. That's one of the, I mean, as you mentioned earlier, as you build all the things that you're doing, you start building equipment like the microphone that you have, like the, you know, the camera that you mentioned, the lights. And you know, we're doing it as, you know, little by little too. Like, it's been growing up organically.
Also breeds, you know,
wanting
to buy more stuff too, you know.
Like, hey, we want 4 camera angles. You're like, well,
that's right.
we need it. That's what we tell ourselves.
Justify it. That stuff's awesome.
Anytime, sure. You know, if you or all the listeners, you know, if they want to talk and you have some questions, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. You know, we are all also learning about this. You know, we might know a couple things that you don't know, and if we don't, we guide you in the right directions in terms of that. Man, it's been wonderful having you. And really, you're a generous guy. You're really just sharing all this different insight on how you becoming a YouTube star, man. You know?
Hey, man, I want to thank you guys for doing this because I like the approach that you're taking with this, because so many people can make a podcast and just talk about whatever or just interview someone. But I like what you guys are doing with the whole brand. And we didn't even talk about brand today.
That's right.
You know, about one of the other reasons why I like YouTube and connecting everything is everything's a piece to the puzzle. It's not like I'm making full time from YouTube, but that's a piece, and breeds more lessons, and more lessons breed masterclasses. And so, like what you guys are doing with Yardbird Entertainment, it's great that you're building a brand and you're doing things within that brand. And I think a lot of people can take note of that. Everybody is an entrepreneur. You know, you just gotta go jump forward.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the hardest part is starting. That. The hardest part about writing a book is sitting down to write a book.
That's right. I mean, main thing we want is, you know, if this podcast can, you know, bring some to the table for other people and answer some questions, that's what we're trying to do, really connect. Yeah. And you know, it's definitely just really tapping from the perspective of a jazz musician, you know, Jazz Biz 101, really just shedding some light on these things that were either taboo or things that maybe a jazz musician, you just gotta know the changes and that's it. You know what I mean?
Oh, man, don't get me started. You know how I feel about that whole thing when people try to put on this persona like, well, man, back in the 50s, they didn't have to worry about. Yeah, you're right. They didn't 70 years ago. That's you're right.
Right. It's like, they also had a whole host of other problems.
But. Oh, that's right. People are like, oh, man, I don't want to be a teacher, man. I'm a creative musician. Like, once again, why does that have to be one or the other? Why can't you start a business? Why can't you do these things?
Or it's like, man, I'm just, you know, I just want to play, man. But
that's great.
Okay, cool. All right, go ahead. But like, you wake up at freaking 3 p.m, you know, and you didn't do any work before that, you know, and you just go out and I'm not hating or anything.
No, but, I don't want to go down this rabbit hole because I can go. And you know, by the way, I apologize to everybody. I go on my rants and I talk. I got that New Jersey, like, talk fast. So I apologize ahead of time. But man, or not ahead of time, I already did it. But like, if you want to be a musician, this is for all the children out there that are listening. If you want to be a musician and just play music, that's great. But don't get angry that other people are able to do other things or you know, afford the fancy ramen noodles out of the top fancy top ramen because they decided to go a different route, or they're teaching like, oh man, I could play Cherokee in 15 keys, man. Why am I not making $1,000 a gig? You have to be realistic. You got to be realistic. It's one thing to try to change the system, but it's also another thing to dismiss the system. You can't just automatically say my music is more complex than Taylor Swift's. Pay me more money than Taylor Swift's.
Right.
You know, you kind of have to play the game a little bit. We are living in the real world. So that's, you know, not to like stifle anybody's creativity or their dreams out there, but like you said, like, you know, you didn't do any work all day. All you want to do is sleep till the afternoon. That's if you want to do the work at night, it doesn't, you know, timing doesn't matter, but like,
right.
You got to understand that. Yeah, like you guys right now could just be like laying around doing nothing because you're real jazz musicians, but you're not. You're running a business, doing podcasts, you're doing, you know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right.
And it doesn't make that, it doesn't make your musicianship any less because of all the other things you're doing. And I think people think that. They're like, just, I'm not going to be a middle school teacher because like, people are going to think of me differently. Well, that's on them. If they think of you differently, there's something wrong with them. You know, when you play a gig, like everybody always says, like, you don't need a degree to, you don't need the piece of paper to play a gig. It's all about how you play. So who cares if he was a doctor during the day or was a janitor or, you know, sorry. All right. Sorry.
No, that's cool.
No.
I can go a long time for that. That's
it's completely transparent. And, you know, I mean, those videos of like, this is what, you know, what jazz musicians say and what saxophonists say, make excuses for, like, you know, those videos are a comedy, but they're also like a realism of
they cut deep for some people.
Yeah, they cut deep for some people. Yeah, it could be triggering for like some jazz people, like, like, I say this thing because of blah. But, you know, at the end of the day, you know, you make your own path, you know?
100%.
Yeah, for sure. And I think we're all strong believers of that here. So, you know, we could all agree on that.
That's right.
For sure.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I like the those videos that you create that could create controversy. They actually do that.
I love it.
You know, at least we're talking about it. And even if we're, you know, completely against what you're doing or whatnot, we are already like somebody's presenting something different than what we just think that that's it. And that, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I never try to just, I'm either trying to, a lot of the things I like doing are like fact-based, or at least not fact-based, but like realistically based. I'm not just going to come out and just bash someone or one thing and say, haha, that was funny. I'm going to say like these things that make people think a little bit. Like obviously it's over the top and I'm like, oh man, you got like things you never hear jazz musicians say, wow, that gig paid really well. Yeah. And then you're going to get people who are saying, yeah, but this one time I played this gig that did pay well. Like obviously I know those situations, but it makes you think like, man, these jazz gigs don't pay well. Like, yeah, that is a thing that we deal with, you know? And, and I deal with the pain of that too. It's not like I'm, you know, I've played gigs. I remember one time I played a gig at Cornelia Street Cafe, another former, you know, listen piece.
Oh, I know.
Where I got paid a guarantee by the band and it didn't cover my parking in the garage because I had to park in a garage. Right. The guarantee, did, you know, and it's like, but I can't, you know, so that's a whole nother issue, obviously, that the economics of it. But like, so when I'm saying this stuff, it's not like I'm making fun of someone or anything. I'm saying like, hey, we all live this world. I'm just like trying to, like, you know, people like laugh through the pain. Like that's kind of what I was doing.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
So I try to come and that's like, even with the music stuff, I try to always have substance. Like I'm not going to like not practice and be a horrible musician and then make fun of other styles of music. I'm going to always try to like, you know, keep my house in order as well.
Right.
Of course.
Right.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
also have fun, you know.
The integrity. Yeah. Keep the
integrity
there.
I try, you know, some people don't think I do, but I try. Dude, I could also run a class on, even though I don't have nearly the amount of followers as some of these people, but like, man, some people love to hate.
Yeah.
Some
how to manage haters.
How to manage. Well, I'm going to make a whole video one of these days on my favorite comments through the years. And it's going to be all just hater comments for like 20
minutes. I love
those
YouTube channels that actually, they like, you know, bring up the comments and then they like, they actually talk about it.
Oh, they like read
it.
Yeah, they read it.
For like a whole video.
That's such fun. Yeah, that's a whole nother topic. But yeah, you're going to have to, everybody's, you know, nobody makes fun of the 0-16 football team, but people love to hate Tom Brady. You know what I mean? Like, So if you got haters, you're doing something right.
Right. For sure.
That's right. That's a fact right there.
Yeah.
Man, thank you again. You know, I think we could definitely do another episode with you and talk more in detail about, you know, the hating side of things too. No, or so many other things that you're doing. Obviously you are a busy guy and we appreciate your time of coming to the show.
Well, we definitely hope a lot of listeners got, you know, a lot out of this and definitely follow Dave Pollack and his journey through life. And whatever he does, we'll be there to support. And you also have a Patreon, correct?
Yeah, I did start one during this whole thing, actually.
Oh, okay.
And,
cool.
Yeah, so basically what that, I guess, to explain, because everybody can do it differently, which I think is cool. On my Patreon, it's basically like there's a couple tiers, and you either get like, you know, starting from just having your name at the end of the video to getting like all the lead sheets and audio files directly, you know, for like tunes that I do on the channel.
Mm.
And then up to extra videos. like behind the scenes videos. Like I just posted one about saxophone excuses, and I basically let the camera run the entire time, and I posted that entire video on Patreon. So it's like 33 minutes of the entire, like the filming process. And I stopped in the middle to talk about, like, cause there was one line that was tripping me up and I kept messing up. So when I got it right, I then talked about like recording process. I was like, hey, if you ever try to record, here's some tips of what I'm doing. I show my script and I do some other stuff. So I show behind the scenes, or I'll do like an extra video too, where like, if I do like a session with my buddy Dom on drums, like I won't post all those videos. I'll save one or two and post those on Patreon specifically. So you get content there.
Yeah.
Exclusive content.
Yeah. Exclusive, like stuff that's not never going to go public.
Oh, cool. That's awesome.
Yeah. That's really great. So yeah, we can definitely direct people there as well. And thank you so much, man. It's good reconnecting too, you know.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah, thank you so much. Talking. And it's great to see you guys, and it's awesome to see what you're doing here too.
Wanna thank Dave Pollack for joining us today on Jazz Biz 101. If you liked what you heard, we included all links in the description to follow him on his awesome YouTube channel. If you want to follow what Yardbird Entertainment is up to, you can go to www.yardbirdent.com. Again, that's www.yardbirdent.com. We appreciate your time and look forward to seeing you guys next week. We also have a virtual concert coming up featuring Bill Saxton for Black History Month. So that will be streaming for the whole month of February. Make sure to get your tickets now. Thank you so much. Take care.